don't have any choice but to make this home of ours a manageable, sustainable base, not just for humans, but for the life that sustains us and that we need to respect.
The calcium in your bones, the iron in your blood, all of that was made in stars.
We need each other to survive, and we need each other to understand.
We're all connected together. We're connected up with the history of all of the stars that were formed and dying before we came about.
Is it worth flying off to another Earth to bring our problems? Is it worth going to the moon to put up a Hilton hotel? We are our own worst enemy. Our salvation is on this planet.
Este lugar queda más cerca del cielo. Y no estoy hablando de los metros al nivel del mar, aunque aquí las montañas están casi a 9.000 metros. Del lado de afuera. En este lugar, en uno de los países más pobres de la Tierra, vive el hombre más feliz del mundo. El hombre más feliz del mundo se llama Mathieu Ricard y es francés, pero lleva 37 años viviendo como monje budista y habla inglés con el acento de un hindú. Ricard es hijo de un filósofo y una pintora. Creció en París junto a Buñuel y Stravinsky. Aprendió fotografía con Cartier-Bresson. Es doctor en genética celular y un día dejó todo para venir al Himalaya.
¿Se es más feliz cuanto menos se necesita?
I think simplicity is wonderful. Simplicity of mind, simplicity of speech, simplicity of action. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You see, the mind, intelligence, can be your best friend and your worst enemy.
Mathieu Ricard hoy es objeto de estudio en sí mismo. La Universidad de Wisconsin lo analizó durante meses para detectar su nivel de estrés y para descubrir los efectos biológicos de la meditación en su cerebro. Mientras midieron la felicidad en cientos de voluntarios con un nivel de 0.3, Ricard logró 0.45. Y desde entonces lo llaman así, el hombre más feliz del mundo.
People sometimes so complicated, hope and fear, rumination inside. So much trouble. It doesn't mean that you are stupid, but that means you don't fabricate your own problems. So simple life comes from a simple heart.
monjes festejan en el monasterio Yeshen. Festejan el año de la liebre. Este edificio simétrico pero atolondrado es un recuerdo. Es la réplica del monasterio Yeshen del Tíbet, destruido durante la ocupación china en 1950. Aquí, chicos de 5 a 14 años aprenden música, danza, pintura y filosofía budista. Son cientos de cabezas rapadas y ojos vivaces que espían por los rincones y siempre se ríen como si fuera la primera vez.
I think in the last 20 years, it became more and more clear our mental state can influence our physical state. Like I've been now engaged for 10 years in some neuroscience research about the influence of meditation on the body. And for instance, meditation on altruistic love, we have shown increase the immune system, diminish the inflammation. So there are definitely benefits to the body to train the mind. The goal is to train the mind, but also there are effects beneficial to the body.
Matthieu Ricard fue un puente, el primer conejillo de Indias que investigó el Mind and Life Institute, creado por iniciativa del Dalai Lama en el año 2000. David Vago fue uno de los primeros coordinadores de aquel trabajo.
We know that there are specific parts of the brain stem, specifically in the midbrain, that respond to pleasurable stimuli. And from an evolutionary standpoint, this is important because we need to approach things that are good for us and avoid things that are not going to benefit us. The thought alone of anything could cause anxiety of what's going to happen this evening when I have this meeting or this dinner date or when I'm in traffic later on, I can't deal with traffic. Just the thought alone is what's causing the anxiety, and that if we continue along a trajectory of letting our thoughts be so reactive, they can cause a lot of stress on our system, on our organs, on our mind, on our sympathetic nervous system. And that actually is not good for our immune system. It's not good for our mental health, so not good for our physical health.
Meditation means to cultivate, to transform the mind, to go from mental confusion to awareness, to wisdom, to get rid of the mental poisons. That's the goal of meditation.
Hay un ruido confuso e infernal. Parecen gaitas y tambores. Y el mundo empieza a temblar. El ruido es un camino. Con ese ruido, los monjes de Yeshen entrarán al silencio.
In the beginning, the mind is like a wild monkey. Never stops, always jump, crazy. And slowly, slowly, more calm, more clear, still very, very vivid. It's not dull, but clear, and not swayed by all the thoughts all the time. Becomes like sky, and then you can grow compassion, you can grow altruistic love, focused attention, understanding. So there's a process of getting stability and clarity.
Now, if we think about it in terms of the prescription that the Buddha gave in the beginning to relieve suffering, relieve personal suffering, there was a very systematic way of training the mind that he outlined. And that form of training is what scientists have started to use as a very specific methodology that we can study. Happiness is relative, absolutely. We don't have a good idea of what really happiness is. It can be described as just contentment or relief from some other form of suffering, ecstasy, sexual sort of excitement. There's so many forms of how we describe happiness, but it's a very vague concept. We know so much more about suffering and pain and unhappiness than we do about happiness.
When it comes with the name religion, then people are a little bit afraid. If exercising 40 minutes is good for your health, and if meditating 45 minutes is good for your brain, so there's nothing wrong with that, you know. So if they can really find their riches they're finding, and if they can really find the Buddhist technique can be beneficial for other people, then why don't they, you know, use that and then make more people happier in this world.
Rinpoche quiere decir precioso, y es el título honorífico que los budistas usan para señalar a los lamas reencarnados. Rabjam es un Rinpoche. Lo supo a los 3 años, cuando dibujó el viejo templo de su abuelo en el Tíbet, el templo que nunca había visto.
Generally, I think the world is moving so fast. If we think back 20 years ago, and then we never thought what we are now, not even we imagine. Example, like 20 years ago, we never thought everybody will be walking around with a telephone in their pocket. Before you send a letter, you expect reply within a month or week. And then the fax came. People expect you to reply within 2-3 days. And now email, if you don't reply the next day, they say, what's going on? So even there's more communication, more fast advance, people have less time. I don't know how much it's really helping for the happiness or well-being of the people, all this so-called fast development.
En Katmandú, Dios vive tapado de trabajo. Todos hablan con él, sueñan con él, meditan con él, lo buscan, le rezan, le hablan, le confiesan, lo añoran, lo escuchan. Esta es la ciudad de los templos budistas e hinduistas, la de los uniformes divinos, los hinduistas ataviados con sus saris, los budistas envueltos en las túnicas amarillas y bordó. Y también la ciudad de los caminos, de los que llegaron aquí por el camino corto de las drogas en los 60 o por el camino largo de la meditación. La Plaza Durbar es la capital exagerada de la fe. El aire es húmedo y de esponja. Hay incienso y fuego y gente y más gente que se tropieza en su camino al paraíso.
Uno encuentra en sociedades como Nepal grandes contradicciones sociales, de mucha pobreza, mucha riqueza, pero a la vez un estado de quietud en cuanto al reclamo. La gente no es violenta. ¿La religión en ese caso funciona como catalizador de esa violencia? ¿Evita que esa violencia suceda?
At least in a, so in a Buddhist environment, like some, or in a Eastern environment, I think the people are trying basically, because it's a less individualistic society, so there's less space for resentment. It's more based, the villages, the communities are more based on family structure, big families, a cooperation in the village. So there's less space for individualistic people becoming, you know, very powerful and other individualistic people being jealous and feeling resentment. I think the fact that in the Buddhist culture, there's more this feeling that all sentient beings are equal and that we should cultivate compassion. So it is not passive, but it's just a better, I think, understanding of a less individualistic society. And the second thing, if there is more value to the inner values, you know, the most respected people here are not the rich people. They are the most wise people, the spiritual masters. You don't feel jealous of them. You want to become like them. So therefore, if you see someone very rich, you're jealous because you cannot get that wealth. But if you see a spiritual master, you are inspired and you get his teaching and you can become like him. So instead of being jealous, you feel inspired by that person. So it's a different process.
Usually there's a metric for measuring happiness through general well-being. Ditella and McCullough in 2006 put together a number of graphs that sort of graphically depict how we experience happiness. And so they showed in relation to global domestic products, so the GDP. The GDP is usually a good assessment of how society is doing. And most people equate material wealth and gain with a source of happiness. And this graph actually shows you that that's not the case. From when they started measuring this, they show in 1975 all the way to the current day, actually this may be around 1998, the GDP has been getting progressively larger in the US, and most developed countries actually have the same sort of a result. So as the GDP goes up, happiness does not. Material wealth, things like money, things like a new car, a new job, status. These are all things that make us happy, but they're very transient, they're very ephemeral, they're short-lived. But a more sustaining or long-lasting form of happiness is harder to obtain, and we know that. But as this field is continuing to grow, I think we're starting to understand that there are very specific practices that one can cultivate, very specific skills that you can cultivate to achieve a longer lasting happiness.
¿La felicidad tiene que ver con lo que se tiene o con la moderación de las cosas a las que se aspira?
In the more advanced countries, where we now have a good long measurements of happiness over time, the whole population do not become happier as they become richer. And the reason is that people are comparing their riches with those of other people.
Lord Richard Lyers es economista y lo llaman el zar de la felicidad. Su libro Felicidad, lecciones para una nueva ciencia, logró que el gobierno inglés incluyera la felicidad en las cuestiones de Estado y fue traducido a más de 20 idiomas.
There's been this tremendous change in the political attitude to happiness during the last 10 years. I think it would be true to say that until then, nearly every politician thought that economic growth was the most important possible objective for their country. And they have looked at other measures like happiness as alternative measures to the gross national product, which is very much influenced by the fact that we have not had increases in happiness as people have become richer in Britain nor in the United States, and that therefore we should be turning to these other sources of happiness, human relationships, and of course the inner sources of happiness that Mathieu Ricard is very concerned with. These should be the focus if we actually want to get onto a higher level of happiness.
Interestingly, this depends on a very critical factor, the happiness and household income. And that correlation, that positive correlation that you see here, is really dependent upon that one critical factor, and that's that whether the relationship that the people have with their neighbors, with their friends, with their peers, if they know that they're making more than their peers and their neighbors, then they're happier. But if they think that they're not making more money than their neighbors, then they're not happier. So that's a very critical sort of point in understanding how happiness relates to income and material wealth, material gain.
¿Qué cosas tiene?
My things is, what bring me joy is to take care of 20,000 children with our humanitarian projects, to help 100,000 patients with our clinics. Mm-hmm. And besides that, I have one pair of shoes.
One?
And another one for inside.
Two.
Ah,
okay, looks.
I have no house, no land, a small room here, of course, I'm welcome. I have a small hermitage in the mountain, but belongs to the monastery, so I'm free.
La identidad de los países se muestra en los silencios y en los pequeños gestos. Tendrían que haber visto, como vi, la actitud reverencial de los tibetanos con sus monjes. Al saludarlos, se inclinan respetuosamente, casi hasta llegar al suelo, y el monje les pone la mano en la cabeza como si fueran niños, quizás porque esos son, y luego se levantan y se van felices, habiéndose inclinado ante la sabiduría. Yo me siento nuevamente ignorante, parte de una raza que se inclina ante un BMW o un Rolex. Definitivamente idiota, un frívolo, envidiando a los que no tienen nada. Ningún mortal puede ver a la Kumari. La Kumari está ahí, detrás de esa ventana, pero nadie puede verla. Kumari es la diosa viviente de Nepal, la reencarnación de Taleju, y solo un par de veces al día su sombra aparece por la ventana, un segundo o dos, lo suficiente para volver a la oscuridad del Kumarigar, su palacio de dos pisos. La Kumari no nace diosa, sino que la eligen como tal. A los 4 años, después de una cuidadosa selección, y diosa será hasta su primera menstruación, cuando la divinidad escape de su cuerpo y se vuelva otra vez persona. La diosa vive todos esos años sola, con su familia, sin cruzarse jamás con persona alguna. Y una vez al año, sale a la luz del sol, al frente de una procesión. Cuando dejó su carrera para empezar a venir a estudiar budismo, ¿con qué pensó que se iba a encontrar?
So first I came to India, to Darjeeling, and I had seen documentaries about the great spiritual master from Tibet who had fled the Chinese invasion of Tibet. I was so impressed, I said, I must go and meet these masters. So I didn't know yet, you know, I was out of curiosity, but after I met them, I realized they were really extraordinary people. So I went back and forth for many years, and after 6 years, I finished my PhD and I decided to live there in Darjeeling in India.
¿Y qué fue lo que lo decidió?
Well, first it was the actual meeting with those very wonderful persons. But there was something about them, it is difficult to describe, about wisdom, about compassion, about this serenity, inner peace. They were the example of what they teach.
Matías Ricard maneja proyectos humanitarios en Nepal, la India y la región del Tíbet. 16 clínicas y 7 escuelas que albergan 800 niños que viven como nómades en el Himalaya. Su ONG se llama Karuna Shechen. Karuna significa compasión en sánscrito.
These clinics all together treats 40,000 patients a year. Now we have 10 years of activities, 50 people work here, and half of the patients are treated for free.
Namaste. Namaste, namaste.
So how is today?
Little bit.
Heavy.
So what we try to do with a patient is to develop their capacity of sizing the present moment. And just to enjoy the life when it's, whenever it's still possible for them. No, we have to be good at listening to the patient, listening their fear about the imminent death, their fear about what will happen when they will disappear, and especially for their children. We have allopathic medicine, the Western medicine, and we have also Tibetan medicine. We have dental clinic, we have palliative care, we have also acupuncture, physiotherapy sometimes. It's quite large possibilities for the patient.
So this is part of our humanitarian effort within Karuna Shechen, the foundation that now we did 111 projects since 10 years. So this is one of our main projects.
Mathieu wanted to call the association Compassion in Action. But this seems too much Buddhist philosophy. So it changed with Karuna Shechen. Karuna means compassion in Sanskrit. And Shechen is the name of his monastery.
They say, I will be a good contribution to society. I will not tell lies. There will be a peace bomb in society. So they do all this pledge. And when they sing, they say, if your eyes see everything as thorn, then the thorn is everywhere. If your eyes a flower, then you see flowers everywhere. So it's education of the heart also.
And go. Thank you.
If we will not get education, so it's difficult to survive in the whole life. I providing to my kids a global type of education, and education helping us to become a good person. The education not helping us to killing each other.
Las escuelas se llaman bambú porque de bambú están hechas. Son sismoresistentes y muy baratas de construir. Reciben a niños de la calle y sobre todo niñas en un país donde las familias eligen pagar solo los estudios de los varones. En Nepal, solo el 26% de las mujeres sabe leer y escribir, contra el 62% de los hombres. Las 5 escuelas de Mambú educan en inglés y nepalí a 15.000 alumnos.
To become a good person, it's not easy thing, not immediately. So I hope so my kids will become a good person one day and helping more and more helpless people in entire Nepal through education.
Compasión es una palabra difícil porque en español se tiene compasión por alguien inferior. Usted habla de compasión en el sentido de hermandad, de fraternidad.
It is the same problem in French.
Okay.
In French, compassion is like pity, so very different. In Buddhism, the root is altruistic love, the wish that all sentient beings, not only human but all living beings. Find happiness and the cause of happiness.
Compassion, also in English, has dropped so far out of our frame of reference that we think it means pity. Or feeling sorry for people, looking down on people in a gracious way. In fact, it comes from a Greek and Latin root, meaning to experience something with something else. That's to put yourself in other people's shoes. The golden rule, look into your own heart, discover what gives you pain, and then refuse under any circumstance whatsoever to inflict that pain on anybody else. Never treat others as you would not like to be treated yourself. Now, in the Buddhist tradition, the word translated compassion is karuna. And that implies an absolute positive determination to rescue all peoples from their pain.
So now, when this benevolence, this altruistic love, not just for the dear one, but for everyone, meets with suffering, then becomes compassion. So it's very deep, because compassion wants to remove the deepest cause of inner suffering.
That sort of ability, empathy, for example, to empathize with someone, or compassion, to express compassion, to cultivate compassion for another person's suffering, those seem to be listening areas, activity in areas of the brain that are very widely distributed through the brain. But I think we're starting to realize that the lasting form of happiness is no longer related to oneself, but to ourself in relation to everyone else.
Es curioso porque uno diría que la religión y la ciencia se pelean.
Not with Buddhism. Buddhism is a science of mind. It's not just a religion where we have, there's no blind faith, just to believe something that you don't understand. It's basically about transforming yourself to achieve some kind of awakening. Buddhism is not a theistic religion.
As a Buddhist, we don't really necessarily believe in a God as a creator. We believe there is a God. There's many different realms. We call it God realm, demigod, human, animal, and then we also believe in hell realms. So these are all is within your mind. But we don't say that there's some kind of a big entity that made everything. That we don't really. But then if we start believing that, then there's lots of doubt, lots of questions. Who is that? Who created that? The Buddhist view cannot be just a blind faith. It has to be understood through analyzing. Then how to put this view useful into oneself, that is what we call Buddhist practice. So we can say Buddhist science, Buddhist view, and Buddhist practice.
So a true understanding of reality is freedom. The Dalai Lama says many times, if any idea of Buddhism is proven wrong by science, we should give it up. We're looking for the reality, not for some kind of dogma.
El tibetano se festeja durante 9 días. El 10º día, la fiesta se transforma en un regalo para la comunidad y allí se bailan las danzas sagradas del Lama. Así sucede desde el siglo IX.
Every aspect of the costume, there was mask of the objects, is symbolic. Some are symbolizing the transformation of the 5 poisons of hatred, attachment, jealousy into 5 wisdoms. So everything has a meaning, and it is a projection in the outside of inner meditation. It is a meditation, but with gesture. Evil is just the mental toxin, mental poisons, hatred, jealousy, aggression, pride, arrogance. That is the real evil. There's no other evil than grasping to the self and having contempt for others, not having any consideration for the suffering and happiness for others. That's the evil. There's no something outside with hate, nothing like that. Inside, hatred. Ultimate evil.
¿A qué le temen?
Ignorance, hatred. I will be very fearful if I think that hatred will come in my mind.
sacan afuera sus demonios para poder desprenderse de ellos. La gente silba, patea el piso, abuchea, ve a los demonios propios en los disfraces ajenos. ¿De qué tendría que disfrazarme acá? ¿Cuáles serían mis demonios? ¿Qué cree que sucede después de la muerte, si es que cree en algo?
Yo, the Dalai Lama says, I'm very curious to see what's going to happen.
I'm curious, yes.
So, according to Buddhism, the stream of consciousness continues. So there will be different state of consciousness after that. But the thought of that is very important so that we don't waste any moment of this life already. Because if we forget that, say, oh, I can do that later, I can do that later, and then life goes. But if we think that, oh, that can come anytime, and every moment is so precious. Every moment of life is lived in the best possible way. Then at least no regret. Living being, not only man, wants to be happy, doesn't want to suffer. Nobody in this world wakes up in the morning thinking, may I suffer the whole day and if possible my whole life. We need not only to achieve happiness, but we also need to contribute to happiness of others. So selfish happiness does not work. Altruistic happiness, concerned by others, that is, I think, a much better mission.
Es curioso cómo de pronto algo tan lejano nos une. Ellos y nosotros conocemos de memoria los venenos de la mente, los que no nos dejan conciliar el sueño. Ojalá fuera tan fácil sacarse los demonios así, romper las máscaras, patearlos en el piso, reírnos, nuevos, frente a lo que ya no queremos ser.